Okay. As you remember, last week we stopped at this point, and now we will be considering a different structure. Basically, with this structure, we have two outputs. As opposed to the previous case, which contained only one output, today we will consider two outputs. Is that so much different from the previous case? Mathematically, no, because we're going to be writing the cost function, taking the partial derivatives, and applying the chain rule of the differentiation. Okay, so let's remember what has been happening. We enumerated the neurons. This is the input layer, this is the hidden layer, and this is the output layer. Okay, our network is here. This is our network, okay? And this is the first input and second input. This is the first hidden layer, hidden neuron, and the second hidden neuron. This is the first output, and this is the second output. So remember, there were those bias values, those minus ones for each neuron. So those are considered or treated as a third input, okay? Third constant value input to this layer, okay? A third constant input value to this layer. So we will be considering all those values, but to be consistent mathematically, this is O10, this is O20, and this is O30, okay? This is the last input to this neuron, okay? And we're going to be considering linear output neurons, which means that tau n is equal to, for an nth output neuron, n could be one or two, omega n11 O11, which is multiplying this output, omega n21 O21, n21 O21, okay, n21 O21, yes, this one, and omega n3 O31. This is multiplying the third element. That is enough for computing the first output if n is equal to one. If n is equal to two, this is enough for computing the second output. Okay, we are applying the input pattern to our network and obtaining the network output. And now what's happening? For two output neural network structure, for a two output neural network structure, we have two desired values associated to each one of those outputs. I mean, the desired value for tau 1 is denoted by D1, desired value of tau 2 is denoted by D2. Basically, using these supervisory signals, we can define the error values for each individual pattern, okay? So error 1 is equal to D1 minus tau 1, error 2 is equal to D2 minus tau 2, okay? All right. For a given pattern, we are able to compute the error values observed at the outputs, okay? And now we can now define the cost function that is equal to 1 over 2, the outputs run from, n runs from 1 to 2, desired n minus tau n, that is error n squared, okay? Basically, this is the instant value of the error. Okay, this is the instant value of the error. 1 over 2, n runs from 1 to 2, en squared. Basically, e1 squared plus e2 squared over 2. Okay, this is my instant cost function that qualifies the performance for a particular pattern. Okay. We will be generalizing those cost functions, the cost functions for the entire set of training data. And we will be considering that case, particularly in Levenberg-Marquardt algorithm. Okay. So, delta omega, omega is one of those parameters. I mean, in the rightmost part of this neural network structure, or one of those parameters available in the left hand of this, left side of this neural network structure. And this is a generic pattern, a generic weight or bias of the neural network that is equal to the change on that parameter is equal to minus eta times del cost over del that particular parameter. So we will be modifying, let's say for example, omega 1 here. We will be taking the partial derivative with respect to this parameter. We will be modifying this omega 1 okay? This means that we're gonna be taking the partial derivative of the cost function with respect to this parameter, okay? This is equal to minus eta times n runs from 1 to 2, en times del en over del omega. Basically, we defined the error values here. Dn minus tau n is equal to en. It is given here. So this produces eta times and runs from 1 to 2 summation en times del tau n over del omega. Basically, you measure an output. You measure an error at a particular output and then multiply that error with the partial derivative of that particular output with respect to the parameter of interest, okay? The parameter that is to be updated. Okay, let's be more specific. We will consider the update of the right-hand side of this neural network structure first, okay? Since we observed the errors, now we are propagating the errors back through this network. So first, the rightmost part, then the leftmost part of the network will be updated, okay? So omega ij1 means these parameters, these six parameters, say for example, these green ones, okay? Or these red ones, right? There are six such parameters. Minus eta times del j over del omega ij1. That is equal to minus eta times and runs from 1 to 2, error n times del error n over del omega ij1. So I know these green ones do not influence the error 2, and these red ones do not influence the value of this error 1. So it is possible to separate, it is possible to expand this expression, eta times del eta times error 1 times del tau 1 over del omega ij1, error 2 times del tau 2 over del omega ij1. Basically, you take the partial derivative with respect to the ith output, then the jth parameter that produces eta times error I times output j1, right? Error I times error at the ith output and the output in the previous layer. OJ1 is here, okay? One of those outputs that is multiplying this particular parameter. So it is easy for the output layer because output layer is a linear one and it is very close to the point where we observe the errors. And this is just fine. It is simple to proceed, okay? Delta omega IJ1 is equal to eta times error I times OJ1. I runs from 1 to number of outputs. J runs from 1 to number of hidden neurons, okay? So when it comes to the previous layer, I mean, first leftmost part of this neural network structure, let's say, for example, we are aiming to update the value of this omega 110, okay, this particular parameter, this tick weight, okay? So if you change the value of this parameter, this omega 110, this means that this output changes. If this output changes, since this is connected to both output neurons, this output changes and this output changes too. So the changes in those outputs change the values of these errors. Now I understand that if I change the value of this parameter, both of these errors change. Okay, there is a dependency in between this parameter and all outputs, all errors, okay? Alternatively, there is a path from error 1 to this parameter error to this parameter. So I need to take the partial derivative components that come from the first output, first error, and that come from the second output, second error. Okay, so I need to consider all of those outputs in computing the partial derivative of the cost function with respect to this particular parameter. Okay, previous case was different. Why? Because if you change the value of one of those green parameters, tau 2 does not change. Okay, there is no dependency in between tau 2 and consequently error 2 in between these error 2 and tau 2 and those green parameters. So those derivatives are zero and the expression is simple. But in this case, there is a direct connection in between this parameter and those outputs. Now I have to consider the effect of any change in this parameter and its effect on these errors. Or alternatively, if I will compute the partial derivative of my cost function that is defined over these error values with respect to this parameter, I need to consider all possible routes that connect these parameters to this parameter of interest. Okay, now let's see. It looks a little complicated, but indeed it is not, because when I read this equations, you will see that we are repeating our simple error back propagation algorithm, which says that delta omega ij 0 is equal to minus eta times del j over del omega ij 0. So this part is the MIT rule. This is gradient descent rule. Now I'm writing j into this equation that produces minus eta times and runs from 1 to 2 en times del en over del omega ij 0. Okay, this is the open form of it. And when I write this equation with the output parameters, output values, you see that eta times and runs from 1 to 2 en times del tau n over del omega ij 0. I read here. Okay. Okay, up until this point, I did nothing. Okay, I'm just doing the same steps as I did before. Okay, and this is equal to eta times n runs from 1 to 2, error n times del tau n over del oi1. You saw you are taking the partial derivative of this output with respect to that output. Okay, with respect to the output of a particular neuron in the hidden layer, del tau n over del oi1, del oi1 over del omega ij0. Now I can take the partial derivative of the ith neuron's jth parameter that connects oi to input j, omega ij, oi, del oi over del omega ij0. That is equal to eta times n runs from 1 to 2, error n, it is here, del tau n over del oi, where if you take the partial derivative of tau n with respect to oi, you get the corresponding parameter, corresponding weight value in between this output and those neurons. So that is omega ni1. Those omega ni1s are placed here, okay? It is, those values are one of those parameters with the superscript 1 here, okay? Times del oi1 over del omega i. This is simple because we already did this. This is equal to eta times n runs from 1 to 2 en times omega ni1 del oi1 over del si1 del si1 over del omega ij0. Okay, we expanded this partial derivative here. Basically, now it is really very simple. Eta times some n runs from 1 to 2, en times omega ni1 times oi over si. We know it is a hyperbolic tangent function in this network. Okay, we chose it. 1 minus output square, 1 minus OI1 square, okay, we already did this. And del SI1 over del omega IJ0 is equal to OJ0. These are one of these inputs, jth input, okay? Basically, we derived the update rule for the output layer neurons and for the hidden layer neurons, okay? Hidden layer neuron, I mean, weights of the output layer and the weights of the hidden layer. We made particular choices. Basically, we used a neural network with biases. Biases were minus ones. Output layer was a linear one. And in the hidden layer, we had hyperbolic tangent functions, and our neural network structure was 2-2-2. Okay, so it could, of course, 2-10-2. Okay, it could of course be something different, but in order to explain this lecture, in order to explain what is happening in here, I chose 2-2-2 network to explain easily. Okay. Well, there is a MATLAB hour, but I will not do this. I will skip this because I suppose there is a very nice MATLAB demo in MathWorks site if you install MATLAB software, and I will skip this page. Okay, so please go to MathWorks, install your MATLAB version, and try to explore the neural network toolbox. Basically, I'm not teaching the toolbox of any software, but it is better for you to code, develop your own code to understand what's happening inside. Okay. In the previous discussion, I explained 2-2-2 network structure. Okay. Basically, in general, a neural network could have many hidden layers and many neurons in it with different neuron activation functions. I mean, you choose the same activation for your network, but there are many alternatives. So you can set up your neural network structure by making a number of choices, okay? By deciding on a number of choices. Let's say we have a neural network structure. We will generalize the algorithm. We have a neural network structure that has this kind of a parameter convention. See the slide. I'm saying that in my kth layer, there are nk neurons. In my k minus first layer, there are nk minus one neurons. And in my k plus one layer, okay, there are nk plus one neurons. So if there are, let's say, capital N layers, for each one of those layers, I can define an array that describes the number of neurons available in that layer, okay? Fine. That describes the physical structure of my neural network, fine. So I enumerate, as you see, my neurons in each layer. This is first, second, and nk minus one. This is first jth and nkth neuron. And this is first ith and nk plus one. Okay? So I'm enumerating from top to bottom my neurons. And there is a, from left to right, this kind of a layer structure. From top to bottom, there is a neuron order in each layer. Okay? So pay attention to this connection, okay, to these two neurons. The ith neuron in k plus one layer is connected to jth neuron in the kth layer. There is a weight in between these two neurons, and I call this weight as omega IJK, okay, omega IJK. So With this definition, I can say that the net summation of this jth neuron is SJK. The output of this neuron is OJK. The net summation of this red neuron is SIK plus one, because it is in the K plus one layer. And the output of it is defined as OIK plus one. This is the K plus one layer. And the weight in between these two neurons is called omega IJK, okay? So remember, we defined SIK plus one as J runs from one to NK, because each one of those neurons have a connection to this ith neuron. J runs from one to NK, omega IJK, OJK is summed up to obtain the net summation of the ith neuron in K plus one layer, this red circle, okay? So SIK plus one is computed. If SIK plus one is computed, I told you that I will make my decision. I will choose a hyperbolic tangent function throughout this network as the neuron activation function. And OIK plus one is F of, that F is my hyperbolic tangent, but you may choose another activation function and derive your own equations, okay? F of SIK plus one. So I should say that I consider this weight, that weight, and the last one to compute this equation. Now SI is ready, it is on the left-hand side, and here the nonlinear activation function like this, and we obtained the output as given by this equation, okay? This summation, J runs from one to NK, considers all these neurons in the previous layer, okay? I suppose I am clear at introducing this structure. As we did before, we will start with the output layer and we will generalize our learning algorithm, which is error backpropagation, okay? Now we're gonna assume that K plus one layer is the output layer, okay? Let's say the rightmost layer is the output layer, okay? Output layer. And the output layer neurons have activation functions denoted by F of X is equal to X. I will consider linear output neurons, okay? Do I have to do that? No, I can of course choose something else, but for this particular example, I will choose linear output neurons, okay? Of course, this will simplify some of my equations. J is equal to, the cost is equal to, or the loss is equal to 1/2 times summation I runs from one to NK plus one. I will sweep all those neurons in the rightmost layer. And DI minus OIK plus ones are my network outputs, neural network outputs, tau I's, right? DI minus OIK plus ones are computed and squared and summed up for all terms available in the output. That is equal to 1/2 times I runs from one to NK plus one, EI square. Fine, this is something we are familiar with, okay? Remember, this is our output layer. This is our output layer. This is the neighboring hidden layer, okay? This is the neighboring hidden layer. And these are my variables, SJK, OJK for the jth neuron in the hidden layer, SIK plus one, OIK plus one in the output layer, okay? So I know SIK plus one is equal to J runs from one to NK, omega IJK, OJK, okay? So this is the net summation we compute here, okay? Now, omega IJK is here, and I would like to update the value of this parameter. Here is the update law that is based on gradient descent. Okay. Omega delta omega ijk is defined as minus eta del j over del omega ijk. Okay, let me apply the chain rule of differentiation, minus eta times del j over del oik plus 1. First, I will take the partial derivative with respect to oi, then oi to sik plus 1, then sik plus 1 to omega ijk. Okay, it is clear here. So, minus eta times del j over del oik plus 1, del oik plus 1 over del sik plus 1, times del sik plus 1 over del omega ijk. Fine. I have the necessary relations here and here and here. So, delta omega ijk is equal to minus eta times del j over del oik plus 1. Take the partial derivative with respect to oik plus 1. That 2 will cancel out this 2. Okay. So you will have another minus di minus oik plus 1. Another minus is here. Di minus tau i. Okay. This oik plus 1 is tau i here. Okay. That minus is coming to here. Times oi over si. Del oi over del si. It is computed using this definition. Okay, this is our nonlinear activation function. That's telling me that f prime of sik plus 1, whatever you choose, you take the partial derivative or derivative of your function with respect to its argument. Okay, f prime times del si over del omega ijk, sik plus 1 over omega ijk, sik plus 1 over omega jojk, that produces this term, okay? That produces this term. Basically, for the output layer, it is really very simple to proceed, okay? For the output layer, I can update the parameters of my neural network, okay? For the output layer, it is really very simple. So, using this relation, I can tune the parameters at the output layer, okay? So for each one of those patterns in the training data set, you apply the input pattern, obtain the network output, and then run this rule to update the output layer parameters. So what is next? What is next? We will consider the generalization of this rule. Then we will switch to the hidden layer case. Let's generalize the rule for the output layer. Here it is. J is 1 over 2. I runs from 1 to n k plus 1 di minus tau I square. That is equal to 1 over 2. I runs from n k plus 1. Sum of squares of output errors. This is the gradient descent rule. I will apply the chain rule as given here. Del j over del omega ijk. This is del j over del omega ijk. Okay. That is the gradient of the cost function with respect to a particularly chosen omega. It is this one, and we are taking the partial derivative. That is equal to del j over del oik plus 1, del oik plus 1 over del sik plus 1, and del sik plus 1 over del omega ijk. This is the chain rule of differentiation. So particularly, we have del j over del oik plus 1. Looking at this equation, it is equal to minus di minus oik plus 1. Del oik plus 1 over del sik plus 1 is a simple derivative, that is the derivative of the function f with respect to its argument, that is f prime of sik plus 1, and del sik plus 1 over del omega ijk, it is explicitly written here, del over del omega ijk, this expression is sik plus 1. When you take the partial derivative with respect to this particular element, you're gonna get the coefficient of it. It is ojk. So we will define, this is, let's define symbol, okay? We will define delta I k plus 1 as minus del cost over del s I k plus 1. Del cost over del s I k plus 1. And delta I k plus 1 is equal to, for this expression, di minus oik plus 1, which is the output error, times f prime of sik plus 1, which is equal to the partial, which is equal to the derivative of the nonlinear activation function with respect to its arguments. So the generalized rule of error back propagation is given as delta omega ijk is equal to eta times delta I k plus 1 times ojk. We will derive a similar rule for the hidden layer, but there is going to be a relation in between these deltas defined for the output layer and the deltas for the hidden layer. That is important to obtain a general rule. The importance of obtaining a general rule is the following. It is easy to develop a code in MATLAB or C or Python or whatever, okay? So this is the generalization of the tuning law for the output layer, and that produces this law with this definition, okay? Delta IK plus 1 is equal to DI minus OIK plus 1 times F prime of SIK plus 1, this is multiplied by first eta, then OJK, that produces the current update value for the parameter omega IJK, okay? And this is the cell structure or the connectivity structure that we have to keep in mind while studying these equations, because the neuron number I at the K plus 1th layer is connected to the neuron number J by the omega IJK weight, okay? This variable convention is important for us, and we need to keep all these in mind, okay? So basically, we started with this neural network structure. This assumed that this is the output layer, and we developed a law that updates the parameters available in this part of the network. Now, our question will be to develop a rule that could be generalized for updating the values of the parameters available here or here or going to the left-hand side of this network structure, okay? So, let's proceed. So this is important to understand what is happening in output layer. Basically, if there is a change in this error, that could be because of these weight values. You need to keep this structure in mind to understand the meaning of this delta I k plus 1. It is multiplying error I times f prime of sk plus 1. So it is preparing an equivalent measure of error for all these parameters, okay? With this delta I k plus 1, you are modifying these parameters, okay? For this neuron, you will be computing another delta I value, and you will be considering the weights connected to this neuron, okay? This is important. So we need to notice which weights are affected by error I. This is the ith output, and these weights are affected by these weights, okay? Okay, for the hidden layers, I will stop here and give 10 minutes break and come back and continue my recording, okay?